In the following video, we're going to take a close look at the MagmaFlow editor and the Krakatoa channels modifier. Let's open an existing scene containing the mesh of the Stanford bunny and convert it to a PRT volume using the jitter position, thus distributing the particles randomly through the volume. Let's also add the Krakatoa channels modifier and change its input and output nodes to use the position channel. Once we have selected the position in the output, we can simply select the input and press the button same channel as output, and it automatically sets the channel name to position. So in this case, we are piping the position into position and nothing really changes. If we would create a multiply operator and multiply by a floating point value, the particles would be scaled. In order to create a multiply operator, we can either use the arithmetic category and drag the multiply into the editor, or, which is simpler and faster, we can select the operator first and then hit the multiply key on the numeric keypad. This inserts a new multiply operator, and because the input channel was selected, it gets automatically connected to the first slot. Now we want to create a floating point input. Floating point inputs with values from 1 to 3 and so on can be created by holding the control key and hitting the corresponding number key on the main keyboard. So if I do control 2, it creates a float with a value of 2 and the particles get scaled 2 times. I can change the floating point number and the particles are being scaled up and down. In this case, though, we don't want to multiply the particles, but we want to divide the positions by a floating point number, for example, 10. This makes the bunny 10 times smaller. After that, we're going to add another operator, a floor operator, in order to round down to the closest number. And then we're going to multiply back by the same floating point number in order to return to original scale, but the already rounded numbers will produce a grid of all the particles along all three axes. In order to create the flow operator, we can once again click on the arithmetic category and drag the flow operator from there, or alternatively, using the keyboard with the divide node selected, we can hit A for the arithmetic group and then F for the floor, and the node will be inserted into the floor. Since we have the auto reorder toggle on, the flow is constantly being reordered, and we are currently using the row pattern, which places the nodes in a horizontal row from right to left. Now that we have the flow operator, we want to introduce a multiply node again. We select the flow, hit multiply, and then we connect the existing float to the second socket of the multiply, and now we have a grid with a spacing of 10. And if we would change this value, the grid spacing will also change. We can also expose this control to the modifier panel. We just right-click the node and select Expose Control, and the floating point multiplier for the grid spacing gets exposed in a custom attribute in the KCM position modifier. That means that we can change that value without actually opening the MagmaFlow editor in the future. We can also rename this input to spacing. And once we do this, the corresponding value also gets renamed in the modifier panel. Let's enter 10 again. Now we want to control this effect using volumetric selection. So underneath the KCM position modifier, we introduce a volume select modifier, go into the gizmo mode and scale the gizmo to cover only a very small volume from the whole object. We also switch to vertex selection, and now we want to blend the positions that we just generated using the grid distribution, thanks to the flow operator, with the original positions loaded from the bottom of the stack. In order to do this, we'll select the multiply operator and then hit the B key, which introduces a blend operator. We'll connect the original position into the second slot, and then holding Shift press S, and this creates a selection channel input, which controls now which of the two inputs, the original position or the gridified position, will be used. As we can see now, the gridified effect is outside of the selection, but we want it to be inside. So with the blend operator selected, we press Ctrl W in order to swap the input and the first and the second input, and this gets us the gridified particles in the selection and the randomly distributed ones outside. Of course, we can enable the soft selection in the modifier and dial in any fall off that we want in order to get the gridified particles slowly transitioning into the randomly distributed ones. As you can see, especially in the side view, if we start moving the gizmo up and down, the particles are actually being shifted half a spacing value to the side, because they're being rounded down. In order to counteract this, we'll have to add another operator, an addition operator, right after we produce the gridify value. And to this one, we're going to connect the original spacing value, divided, we create a division operator, divided by a value of 2. This will shift the particles half a spacing value to the side in order to counteract the result of the flow operator. So we can use a control 2 in order to produce a division by 2. And since we are working here with the vector and here with the floating point number, we see that the expected arity, that means the number of components of the value, was 3. That means we expect a vector here, but we're actually getting a floating point number with just one component. So we'll have to convert this one into a vector. So we can click on the convert category and drag a 2-vector into the flow. And since we want to connect all three components of the 2-vector operator to the same divide, we can either drag each one with the mouse, or we can select both and hit the space bar, and this performs a connection from the operator with the lower number to the operator with a higher number. Now, if we start moving the gizmo up and down, there is no shifting to the side, and the gridifying effect is moving with the gizmo as we would expect. At this point, we could try to assign Krakatoa as the current renderer, switch the rendering to force additive mode, and try to render these particles additively in order to see what the result is. As you can see, if we would disable the Krakatoa channel modifier on the stack, we get a completely diffuse cloud of particles, which is rendered additively. That means there is no alpha channel and all the particles are being just summed together. And if we enable the KCM position modifier, we're getting the gridified effect in the middle. Obviously, when we shift the particles close together, since we're using additive rendering, they get much brighter. We could try to counteract this by adding another KCM modifier to the stack, setting the density and switching the input to also use the density, and then subtracting this density value. Actually, we need the selection instead of the density. So in the input, instead of using density, we're going to switch to the selection channel. Using Control W, we'll flip the input so the selection comes into the second slot, and we'll get a floating point number by pressing Control and 1 on the keyboard, and we'll enter a value of 1.1. As a result, whenever the selection is 1, that means fully selected, the result for the density will be 0.1, because you subtract 1 from 1.1, and whenever the selection is 0 at the outside of the gizmo, we're going to get a density of 1.1. Now, if we would render the same image, the particles in the middle won't accumulate that much. And if we would like to reduce the intensity even more, we can change the Gridify effect, which currently pushes all the particles into a single point in space. Inside the blend operator, currently the selection controls how much of the Gridify effect to be used and how much of the position. If we would divide this selection value by the floating point number 2, the effect of the gridification will be just half of the original one. That means that we're never going to reach the single point, the singularity in each of the grid points. If we would start reducing this value towards 1, we'll reach the original result, and values below 1 start pushing it out again. So somewhere around 1.5, we can get a result which creates relatively large points in the middle, but still produces a nice visible grid. Let's render from a slightly different angle. And potentially we could animate the gizmo of the volume select modifier in order to produce an animation of a scan line which is moving from the bottom. We'll switch the tangents to linear, enable auto key, move to the last frame, and keyframe the selection gizmo to pass through the object. And after that, we can render an animation and take a look at the result. Here is the result, already rendered and loaded in the RAM player. The time per frame for rendering this was approximately 1 second. That means for 100 frames, it took about 100 seconds. And here is the resulting animation using about 750,000 particles. Of course, we could increase the subdivisions and render a lot more particles with a lower density altogether in order to produce a much smoother result without all the obvious particles